Corals are animals. You probably already know. But how? I mean, what makes it an animal? Can it move? Does it move at all? What is the mechanism behind all that branch-looking thing? Well, in this episode, we will be visiting the Aquarium of the Pacific to take a closer look at our dear friend corals and to understand what makes a coral. Stay tuned, because we will also be taking an actual dive. Aren't they just beautiful? So these are corals and anemones. They are in the same phylum called cnidarians. So the special thing about it is that they're not plants, they're animals just like you and I. And these tentacles are what they use to feed. So when a fish swims and then their tentacles will sting them, they get paralyzed and they can just eat the fish just like that. And so if you look closely at it, there's like tentacles and inside is the mouth. It's so bright here, there's so much light, and my camera person, my roomie, is very happy now. It's easier to film.
Okay, so why is there so much light here? It's because we have corals. We're in the coral section, and corals live a symbiotic relationship with algae, and algae needs the light to do photosynthesis to get nutrients, and they can share with each other, just like roomies, you know?
Corals in shallow waters can eat in two ways. One is through their mouth, like an anemone, and the other way is through hosting algae. The algae that lives inside the coral provides nutrients for the coral through photosynthesis, like its own personal chef, while the coral provides the algae with protection like a sturdy house. In deeper waters, where sunlight is scarce, some corals have the ability to fluoresce and provide algae with what limited light they have. In even deeper waters, some corals don't even have algae in them at all. They are soft and flowy and get their nutrients solely through ingesting plankton and small floating organisms.
Alright, corals come with all different shapes and sizes. And the one that I want to talk about is behind me, is the one that is like an antler.
Now, you'll find tiny anemone-looking things dotted all along the branches that make the branches look, well, furry. These anemone-looking things are called polyps. And all of the polyps on a single coral are all connected through a thin layer of tissue where they can share nutrients with each other.
Oh my god, yes, there's a magnifying glass. We can look at the polyps that we talked about earlier closely, like clearly with a magnifying glass. Corals can be described as like little anemones, but stuck together on the calcium that they build.
Normally, coral themselves don't have vibrant colors. It's the algae inside them that makes their famously beautiful colors. When water temperatures rise, the algae become overwhelmed and produce harmful chemicals that corals will just expel the algae out of them altogether to avoid further damage. Without the algae, the coral lose their beautiful colors and show their white calcium carbonate underneath. It's called coral bleaching. If the algae don't return, the coral will eventually starve to death and be unable to survive.
So imagine this is the open ocean, and then so you have this cliffside, very steep, and then we go into the crest and into the lagoon and onto the land. And all of this shallow area is where coral grows. Now when the wave crash, it creates a water break so that the shores won't be attacked by the waves too aggressively. Boy that we see here is a parrotfish. Why is it called a parrotfish? Because when you look at its mouth, it's like a beak, you know? It's like reminds you of a parrot. They use this beak to scrape coral, to scrape algae, so they're algae eaters, they're algae feeders. And so are the other fish in the tank that we see here. Now, this big boy can grow up to 100 pounds. If we overfish these coral eaters, these algae feeders, then the algae will naturally overgrow, and that will throw the whole coral system into imbalance. And that's why we need to protect these creatures and not let them go imbalanced.
To get a closer look at coral reef, we traveled across the Pacific Ocean to a coral island called Xiaoliuqiu, 13 kilometers southwest off the main island of Taiwan. Now, why are coral reefs so important? Well, for many reasons. One, with all the crannies and nooks that the reef structures provide, it is home to more than 25% of all marine life. They're even nicknamed the rainforest of the ocean. Two, coral reefs can provide a protective barrier for the coast in which they reduce impact during storms, typhoons, and even tsunamis, saving coastal infrastructures and lives.
Sadly, these are not the videos that we took that day. This is. The coral reef around Xiaolaocheo has gone through major bleaching events, along with the constant pollution from the nearby Gaoping River. What you see here are algae, overgrowing on the remains of the coral skeletons, attracting sea turtles who feast on these algae. A coral graveyard. One fish, not much biodiversity.
I hope that if all of us cut down on our carbon footprint, slow down climate change, perhaps one day, Xiaolaocheo has the ability to return to its original vibrant glory.
Corals are animals. They have cute little fluffy polyps and they're great roommates with algae. Their unique way of living and growing and reproducing makes us understand how diverse and beautiful our world is, even within our own animal kingdom. So the next time you go to an aquarium, or go to a beach, or even just to the grocery store, be grateful that our corals are out there somewhere in the tropical seas, providing us with our livelihood and protecting our very delicate balance. And then we can ask ourselves, what can we do for them in return? If you like this channel, consider clicking the subscribe button so that I can make more videos. Stay tuned, because our next episode is gonna be somewhere old.